So guys, what are we doing with these videos?
Well, you and I are going to talk about circuit breakers.
And we're going to talk about something a lot more exciting than that. We're going to talk about contactors.
Well, I got fuses, and you guys know all about fuses. We protect circuit breakers and contactors all the time.
Whoa, this is not a competition.
You mean like the overcurrent protected device games?
Well, breakers would win.
No way, contactors have it all day. The endurance is there.
600 volts, 300,000 amp interrupting rating and current limiting. Come on.
Well, I think we should talk about the types and applications for all these products, but for fuses, I think we should focus on the ease of use and arc flash reduction.
Sure, we'll hit the fusology and the basics of fuses and hit all of those value propositions.
So, what is a fuse and what are the types of fuses? The National Electrical Code defines a fuse as an overcurrent protective device with a circuit opening fusible part that is heated and severed by the passage of overcurrent through it. The NEC also includes an informational note that tells us that the fuse has all of those parts necessary to perform its function of interrupting an overcurrent, but may not have all of the parts necessary to connect it into the electrical circuit. The fuse has to have those other items we refer to as the fuse holder or fuse block and even the switch to enable replacement of that fuse. Somehow we need to insert that device into the circuit and be able to switch it out of the circuit. So bottom line with regard to a fuse is that it is that part of protection that gives its life to protect. There's no resetting involved outside of replacing it. Fuses come in different shapes and varying characteristics. Basically, what I mean here is how they respond to current being passed through them and their size and shape. The physical aspects of the fuse determine the holder and switch that has to be used to get them in the circuit, and the electrical performance of the fuse defines its ability to protect. UL-248 is the standard that is used to establish the performance of these devices, their fit, form, function, and labeling. UL-248-1 is the general requirements. Beyond 248-1, we have additional documents that identify all of the various types of fuses. Each of these fuses have a purpose and a place in the power distribution system, from the circuit board that may be in your computer to that utility transformer just outside your building. The big hitters out of the list above and where you'll find them include the following. Class CC is listed to UL-248-4 and are small fuses that are fast acting for protection of branch circuits, motor circuits, lighting ballasts, and even streetlight fixtures. Class G is a high performance general purpose branch circuit fuse for lighting, appliances, and motor branch circuits. Then we have the Class RK1, which are fast-acting devices usually applied in general-purpose circuits, but are not suitable for motor loads or transformers with high inrush currents. Class RK5 is a time-delay fuse suitable for protecting motors, transformers, and other types of loads with those low-level, short-duration overload currents. Class T fuses are great solutions for critically restricted space applications, high degree of current limitation, as well for many different types of applications. You can find these in service entrance equipment on residential and light commercial applications. The Class J fuse has no intentional time delays, great for those applications where you don't have heavy motors or transformer inrush currents. Class L are large fuses, fast acting, usually found at service entrance equipment and similar locations within the power distribution system. These are the large units like the 1200 amp or 3000 amp fuse. These fuses that I'm standing next to and that I'm holding here is the Class CF. It has the performance class of a Class J fuse, but in a different format that offers a finger-safe solution. You see, the fuse industry has standardized on this element of protection. These standards provide the size of the box, the length, the width, the diameter. You see, every manufacturer, for example, who makes a Class CC fuse will have the same package that's the same width, length, diameter, etc. So they all can fit in the same holder. The fuse industry leverages rejection features to ensure we don't put a fuse with a lesser capability into the same holder that accepts a fuse with a greater protection capability. It's all about safety. Other electrical equipment may not necessarily go through those same hoops to ensure you don't make a mistake in the field. For example, rejection on interrupting ratings. We have rejection on ampere ratings, and we have rejection on voltage ratings. Outside of the physical construction of the fuse that every manufacturer has to meet, there's what's inside the fuse, and that's where the secret recipe lies. That part of the fuse establishes the performance with regard to current. The level of protection provided, and some cases, the level of compatibility with the load. For example, letting a motor start through its inrush currents. So let's talk a little bit about some of the basic functions that an overcurrent protective device has to do. And then we'll talk about how the fuse gets it done. This, I think, will help us understand where they're applied and how they can be leveraged in the power distribution system. So what does an overcurrent device need to do? The fuse has to protect from heat generated from persistent overload currents and from high magnetic destructive forces of short circuit currents, which can be many, many times greater than overload currents. The fuse is there to protect equipment such as conductors, transformers, motors, power distribution blocks, busway, and yes, sometimes even circuit breakers. You see, the fuse is very efficient at getting its work done. We don't have to worry about anything other than opening the circuit on overcurrents. There's no switching in the fuse. There's no electronic brain in the fuse, trying to capture energy data or waveforms. There's no digital inputs or outputs, taking information in and putting information out. It's got one job to do, it's focused on that job, and because of that, it's great at that job. The fuse puts its job of dealing with overcurrents at the top of the list, and its only priority in life. The fuse can provide protection from many different types of equipment, from the destructive forces of high short circuit currents and the long-term persistent overload currents. So let's now focus on the fact that there are two basic types of fuses, fast acting and time delay. Let's understand these two by giving some examples. First, let's say, for example, you have a large television that when you turn it on, it draws 15 amps and only 15 amps. It's an instant on thing. There would be no reason you would see more than 15 amps. So we put that on a 20 amp circuit protected by a 20 amp fuse. If current goes beyond 20 amps, this fuse is going to open because there's a problem. I want what we call a fast acting fuse because I know there is no reason for current to go beyond that 15 amp load current. My goal is to limit the amount of damage to the load, and to do that, I don't want hesitation. The fuse curve looks like this. You see, it has a little sag in the middle in the overload region. Now, let's talk about my treadmill. There's a motor involved in this treadmill, and let's say that at full load amps, when running, it pulls 15 amps just like the television, and I have it on a 20 amp branch circuit protected by a 20 amp fuse. That motor is going to pull more than 20 amps if I'm standing on it and you turn it on. It will pull, say, 6 times 15 amps for a short period of time to get up to speed. The fuse can't open in that case. The fuse you need here is what we call the time delay fuse. That will let the motor get up to speed without opening, but let's say that I passed out from all the running I've been doing and I fell on the treadmill and the motor locks up and can't turn the belt. The fuse will only give that motor so long to be at locked rotor amps until it says, I'm clearing this circuit because Tom's laying on the belt. Tom needs a time delay fuse for his treadmill. So we've just learned two very fundamental things about fuses and their applications. We understand there are two basic types of fuses, and we have an understanding of where they're applied. We know we have a time delay fuse, which would be applied on those circuits where I have motor inrush currents or I am energizing transformers. Those devices that present temporary overloads shouldn't open the fuse, but we still have to provide protection for conductors from long, persistent overloads. And we still have to provide high short circuit current protection as well. Both of these fuses, though, are current limiting fuses, as the physics behind their design will not let cycles of current flow during short circuit events high enough to be in their current limiting region. No, these current limiting devices will not even let 1/2 of a cycle of current flowing. One cycle is 0.016 seconds. 1/2 of a cycle is 0.008 seconds, or 8 milliseconds. Not only does the fuse limit the amount of time that the current is permitted to flow, but it also reduces what we call the peak current from hitting a very high value. You can see that in this image, which shows a short circuit current flowing for 3 cycles as compared to what a fuse would let flow. This translates into reduction of heat and stress on the power distribution system. These videos illustrate the aspect of current limitation and its impact on the power distribution system during a fault. Both of these videos have the same circuit configuration. We have a length of 2-aught conductor, and we are going to let a fault current flow through it. The first video shows you 1 cycle of fault current. The second video shows you what the current limiting fuse brings to the table by limiting the peak of the current and the length of time that that fault current is permitted to flow. Limiting the peak reduces the magnetic forces. Limiting the time reduces the heat. I use this video in many educational situations. I can speak to it with regard to the importance of proper torque on terminations, incident energy reduction, and even short circuit current ratings. In reality, the fuse helps with all of these because of what we just saw. When fuses are used ahead of a piece of equipment, they are often applied to increase the short circuit current rating, or SCCR, of that equipment. This fundamental principle of the fuse was discussed in my video on short circuit current ratings with the weightlifter example. Let's take a look at the components that make up a typical fuse. So here's a picture of what is inside the fuse. I think the first thing that you should recognize is how simple this device is. I mean, this is like looking under the hood of a race car and not seeing some huge souped-up engine, but rather a little nuclear tube or a rubber band. There are no levers, linkages, or other parts and pieces inside of that tube that are necessary for doing what this device is arguably one of the best at doing in the industry: clearing overcurrents to provide protection. What you're looking at now is our secret sauce without the details. There are 2 key areas of the fuse that do the work. The first area I'll talk about is this little pin-like piece of the recipe which opens when an element inside melts, causing that little piece to pull and separate. That is the overload protection we talked about earlier. These lower persistent overcurrents have to persist long enough to melt this portion of the element and open. Low currents flowing long enough to melt something means that if I have a current that is there and then disappears, this device does not open. But if the current persists, it will open. Now, the other area I'm going to address are all of these little holes and what I call pinch points. Looks like little baby Swiss cheese. This element carries current, and what happens on very high currents, these little pinch points basically erupt. Now, what I'm not showing you is all of the sand that surrounds this element. This entire cavity is filled with sand, and when those pinch points see very high fault current that causes them to heat and open, the sand surrounding these points turn to glass. And we all know glass is a very good insulator. These pinch points are what do the work to limit those very high fault currents and protect equipment. It's amazing if you really think about it. This is a medium voltage fuse from a current limiting utility cutout. You can see the sand inside and what happens to the sand when it melts.
So where are fuses installed? Fuses can be found in many locations: in your vehicle, on your boat, in a panel board, in a switchboard, in switches, motor control centers, in cords, in line with a conductor. Fuses can even be found on a circuit board. When a fuse is applied, there is typically a special need, like one of the following. Number 1, high interrupting capability. Where would I have a lot of fault current in a power system? The closer I am to the utility service entrance. So you could see fuses applied at service entrance switchboards or switch gear. But the definition of high with respect to current is relative to the application. Think about your computer with that little green circuit board with all those small electronic parts. I may not have 150,000 amps at that board, but 20 amps flowing through one of those traces would be very destructive to that sensitive equipment. So it would not be uncommon to see a fuse protecting those circuit board traces. 2, current limiting. The magnetic forces generated during a fault increase disproportionately faster than the increase in current. Actually, those forces increase by the square of the fault current. Products that can't tolerate those magnetic stresses frequently use current limiting fuses. And lastly, selectivity. Because of the physics behind how a fuse operates, as long as you ensure that the amp rating of any two fuses in series of the same type have at least 2-to-1 ratio, the downstream fuse will always clear before the upstream fuse, regardless of current, maintaining a selectively coordinated system. If I put a fuse downstream close to the load, that faster clearing time may mean I can reduce the size of upstream circuit breakers. This can reduce system cost, as well as potentially reducing arc flash energy, all the while still achieving high levels of selectivity. Faster clearing is a good thing the closer we get to the load. So what ratings are important when deciding what fuse to apply to your system? Voltage, ampere rating, interrupting rating, and is it an AC or DC application? Since all fuses are straight rated, meaning they should be applied at the rated voltage or below, you don't have to worry about the configuration of the system, like whether it is corner grounded or Y grounded. For medium voltage applications, it's important that the fuse voltage rating matches exactly the voltage to which it is applied. This helps ensure that the transient voltages produced from the extremely high speed clearing don't exceed the BIL rating of the medium voltage equipment. From an interrupting capability, most fuses have a very high interrupting rating, removing the worry of what the available fault current is. One less thing to worry about. Aside from types of fuses we've already discussed, there are fuses that are used in special applications. We'll discuss a few here, specifically high-speed fuses, which are for semiconductor applications used in VFDs and other similar power electronic equipment. Those fuses are sized based on the energy or I squared T that they let through. Supplemental fuses are put inside equipment as backup for the main protective device. Finally, you've probably heard the term limiters used in low voltage systems to describe a device very similar to general purpose fuses. Limiters are connected in series with other OCPDs. The difference between a fuse and a limiter is that the limiter only clears very high current faults, fault currents that are above the interrupt rating of the OCPD. In other words, adding a limiter increases the short circuit current rating of that OCPD.
If there's anything I think you should take away from this discussion, is that the power of the fuse is in its simplicity in more ways than one. We have straight voltage rated fuses, high interrupting ratings. We have a 2-to-1 ratio for selective coordination, rejection features, and current limitation. If you want to learn more about different types of fuses and how they can be used to protect your power distribution system, contact us or your local Eaton representative to schedule a visit to the Power Systems Experience Center today.